Good morning. Thank you for joining us here at Central Baptist Church in Bedford, Texas. We pray that you'll enjoy the services, the beautiful music, and a word from our pastor. And now let us start with a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you this morning, this time of uncertainty, that we know that without you we could do nothing. But more than ever, Lord, we just need help to love our neighbors and let your light shine before them, Lord. We pray for healing and a cure for this plague. God, just give the doctors and nurses and all the healthcare workers and others, Lord, the strength to persevere and keep them safe. Lord, as we celebrate this beautiful Easter morning, let us remember that Jesus conquered the grave and hell so that we could have everlasting life. Thank you for your love for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I want you to put everything you got into it. There is power in the blood. Would you be free? Let's sing it.
Would you be free?
There is power.
in the precious blood, in the precious blood.
Good morning. Join me in Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 10. Now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, and for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen, as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell the disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you." So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." Amen.
I stand
redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. This is an awesome lyric. Let's sing it together. Here we go. Sing.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, redeemed through his infinite mercy.
Good morning. I want to invite you to go on a journey with me this morning on this Resurrection Day of celebration. I want to take you into a courtroom, and hopefully you can picture with your mind Satan, the accuser, sitting at one table. And he's got some of his demons, his fellow lawyers, by his side. At the other table is Jesus, our advocate, our lawyer, the one who stands in our behalf. Also with him, a couple saints and New Testament writers. Looking up behind the judge's bench is the righteous, almighty judge, our Heavenly Father, the creator of the universe. In the witness stand is those that Hebrews spoke about, the cloud of witnesses, those who speak of the truths of God, those who died in faith and now know for sure that all that God said is true in His Word. In the room also, all the unbelievers and believers of all time gathered around in the seats behind the lawyers. And there's tension in the room as Jesus begins to make His opening statements, He and His fellow lawyers. Jesus stands as our righteous advocate, and He begins to make the argument that He has already paid the sins for all mankind. Anyone who would believe in Him would not perish. And so Jesus sits down, and His first fellow lawyer stands up. John the Beloved begins to speak, and he says, "My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous." And he points to Jesus. He says, "He is the propitiation for our sins, not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world." Anyone who would believe in Him. John the Beloved sits down, and the mighty Apostle Paul stands with his booming voice, well-trained in public speaking, well-trained in political environments, well-trained in legal environments, and he begins to declare to everyone in the room, "Who is to condemn us? Jesus Christ, the one who died, more than that, who was raised from the dead, He is at the right hand of the Father, who indeed is interceding for us. So who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? Yea, in all these things we are more than conquerors for them who are in Christ." Jesus stands and begins to make His opening statement, the bold statement from the cross in Mark chapter 15. At the end of the day, after He had suffered great punishment for our sins, and He had given the payment for all mankind, He cried with a loud voice, and He's standing in the courtroom declaring that truth, "It is finished." Just a few days before the resurrection, when they took Him innocent to the trial, and this mock trial that condemned Him, and He gave His life for us, He did not utter one word of defense or argument. He stood in our place, and He reminds everyone in the courtroom this morning, "It is finished." After He sits down from His bold opening statement, Satan begins to make his opening statements and accusing Jesus, accusing all of us, brothers and sisters in Christ, accusing anyone who would dare to believe in Christ and come to Him. And He sits down, and then Jesus begins to give the evidence, the case that He is the payment for all sins. This body of evidence just simply includes the life that He lived. Jesus Christ lived a sinless life. In fact, Scripture tells us He became sin, the one who knew no sin, that we might become the righteousness of God. Jesus declared His perfect life, His ministry of compassion and mercy and grace. The miracles, the 5 loaves and 2 fishes, the blind man, the lame man, the one at the pool of Bethesda, the young boy in the village of Nain who was dead. All of these miracles He begins to declare and make this argument with the body of evidence. And then He ends His case. He ends His argument of who he is and how he came to save us with these seven declarations that he made during his life on this earth. He says, I am the resurrection and the life. I am the light of the world. I am the bread of life. I am the gate. No man can come and go unless they go through me. I am the good shepherd. I am the vine, the true vine. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. The courtroom seems to be stunned and silenced as Satan really has no argument. He's freaking out. Him and his demons are making all kinds of noise and bringing all kinds of lies and accusations, but the truth of Jesus stands firm in that room. And as if to make a blunt final argument, he points to Resurrection Day. Jesus stands up to close his argument and to let everyone know, remind everyone who he is and all that he's done. And the final blunt argument comes from our text today in Matthew chapter 28. The morning when the women came to the tomb and the tomb was empty, and the angel said to those women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen." And he said, "Come see the place where he lay." As if that was a strong enough final argument and final statement to make the case that he is the righteous Savior, the Messiah who died for our sins and overcome the grave. He reminds us what happened when he was on the cross in Matthew chapter 27. When he declared, "It is finished." The Bible tells us in verse 51 of Matthew 27, the veil of the temple that kept common man from the mercy seat, from the throne room of grace, it was torn from top to bottom, and there was an earthquake, and rocks were shattered, and the graves were open. I want you to listen to this and imagine this. While Jesus was on the cross and he declared, "It is finished," the graves were open, and those who had already died, believing in Christ, many of those came up from the grave, were resurrected, and they came out of the graves after the resurrection, and they went into Jerusalem and appeared to many. I want you to imagine yourself if you lived in Jerusalem on Resurrection Day. There was already enough chaos and worry and excitement around the city, but now you wake up Sunday morning, and not only have you heard that Jesus' body is not in the tomb, you start seeing your neighbors who you knew had died and declared that the Messiah was coming before they died, who died in faith, you see them coming to visit their family members. You see them walking down the street to celebrate Sunday with their families. These that were dead in the grave, but their lives had proclaimed that they believed, they looked forward to the Messiah coming. They died in faith. The Bible tells us here in Matthew 27, and Jesus is declaring in this courtroom, this is another piece of evidence that those that were dead in Christ were made alive, were resurrected, and were walking the earth again. And we have hope today because of this truth. Jesus, as he makes his case to the righteous judge, to all of the cloud of witnesses, to all the believers and unbelievers throughout eternity, to Satan and his demons, he is making the argument, this from the bold opening statement that on the cross he declared, "It is finished. I paid for your sins." And then all of the evidence, this body of evidence that he put forward, his miracles, his ministry, his life, the message that he preached, and this great final argument on Easter Sunday that we celebrate today, he overcame death. For those who believe in Christ, it was amazing that Jesus would be willing to die on the cross for our sins. It's amazing that knowing we are sinners, not worthy of his love, dead in trespasses and sin, he would still die on the cross for us and pay the payment for our sin, and he declared, "It is finished." But he didn't stop there. He proved that for those who believe in him, he has power over death, hell, and the grave. And for those who die in Christ, that is not the end. Our soul is immediately with God in heaven when we leave this life. But one day, that's not the end either. One day, in Thessalonians, Paul told those believers in Thessalonica, chapter 4, he says, "I don't want you to be ignorant concerning those that are asleep, those who have already died in faith. Do not sorrow as others who have no hope. If we believe that Jesus died and rose again, those who sleep in Jesus, God will bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord. Listen. That we which are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord, we will not prevent those who have died before us. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, just like on resurrection day. All those believers, those many graves that were opened, who had been resurrected. For we which are alive in Christ shall be changed. He says, the Lord will descend in verse 16, the trump of God, the dead in Christ shall ride first. Then we which are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds, and we will meet the Lord in the air, and then we will forever be with the Lord. And Paul tells those Thessalonian believers, comfort one another with these words. You see, because Jesus paid for our sins, because Jesus overcame death, hell, and the grave, and promises to us that those who have faith in him, those who belong to him, one day we will see the same fate. When this body dies, we will be put in the grave just like Jesus was, and our soul will be with God in eternity. But one day, at the end of all time, this body will come out of the grave, and this body will be perfected and made new, and I will worship God eternally because Jesus Christ, my advocate, my lawyer, stands in my place. When Satan accuses me, Jesus stands up at the table and says, my blood has covered his sin. And not only that, when death comes to this body and those around me are grieving and Satan speaks into their mind, now what about your Jesus? Now what about your hope? Jesus will stand firmly, just as he did when my sins are accused against me in front of the judge. Jesus will stand firmly and say, there is hope. He lives again because he belongs to me. So in this courtroom, I hope today, as you have joined me in this courtroom and enjoyed this scene, I hope that you can imagine in your mind this truth. This is not make-believe. Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins and for mine. Jesus rose from the grave the third day, and he has power over death, hell, and the grave. And those who belong to him, those who die in Christ, will be resurrected one day and will live eternally with God. And that is the hope of the resurrection. That is the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. Because he died for us, because he overcame the grave, that's why we celebrate Easter, to celebrate that he has power over death, over our sins, over Satan, over all that is evil, and he has already won all of eternity. And so you and I have the opportunity to enjoy all of that hope that he offers to us, all of the joy that he offers to us in Christ, all of the promises that he had given to us in his word, if you have a relationship with Jesus Christ. And on this Easter Sunday, I don't want to take for granted that someone who's watching knows what that means. I don't want to just assume that everyone knows what that means. Well, I go to church. I know God exists. I put money in the plate. I do good things. Jesus told a good church-going guy named Nicodemus, you must be born again. There's a moment of faith where we are confronted with the fact that we are sinful creatures, and without Christ, we have no hope. And Jesus makes this argument in this courtroom today before you and for me. Friend, if you do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ, I want to invite you to engage with Jesus today. Accept the payment that he paid for your sins. You can very simply, right there where you're watching, simply pray a prayer and ask Jesus to save you and begin your journey with Christ. You can ask God to forgive you, and he will. Jesus says that he is faithful and just to forgive us. And he invites you into a relationship with him. And if his Holy Spirit is drawing you, that feeling of that desire that you have inside of you, you cannot explain. That's a heavenly, loving, all-knowing, all-powerful God inviting you into relationship with him through his Son, Jesus. And I hope today that everyone who's watching this has no doubt of their faith in Christ and no doubt of their walk with God and their relationship with him. And we can celebrate with hope today because Jesus died for our sins, and 3 days later, He was resurrected, came back to life to prove that he has power over all hell, over all of our sin, and over death and the grave. And we have hope because of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.